to speak to you briefly this morning on a topic that the Holy Spirit said, your garment. Your garment. And I will be relying on Ephesians chapter 5, verse number 27. Ephesians chapter 5, 27. Ephesians 5, 27. The word of God says that he might present to himself a glorious church, which is you and I, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that she should be holy and without blemish. I read the word of God again. Ephesians 5:27. 5:27, 5:27. That he might present to himself a glorious church, which is you and I, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that she should be holy and without blemish. In the word of God, I have come to discover that there are certain words or names in the Bible that the Bible took particular interest in. If we say, for example, rivers, you know, you see the Bible talking about River Jordan, River Abana, River Nile, River Papa. If we mention the word mountain, you see the Bible talking about Mount Gilboa, where Saul died, Mount Zion, Mount Gerizim, where the blessings were pronounced, Mount Pisgah, where Moses died, Mount Nebo. When we are talking about valley, you see the Bible talking about valley of Aijalon. You see the Bible talking about the valley of Elah, where Goliath was killed. Now, I take particular interest in such things because of their variety, because of the fact that you can learn from this mountain what you cannot learn from that. You can learn from this river what you cannot learn from that, because all scriptures are useful. So says the word of God. But this morning, I'll be focusing on the word garment. Bible made copious references to the clothes that we wear. Sometimes those clothes are called garments. Sometimes they are called raiments. Sometimes they are called linen. They have been called ephod, and they have been called tunic. But for the purpose of this teaching, we will be focusing on the word garment. I'll just start with some random thoughts about that word garment. See, when God needed to cover man's shame in the Garden of Eden, he used a garment of skin, which we found in Genesis chapter 3, verse 21, Genesis 3, 21, Genesis 3, 21. Now, God particularly described Aaron's garment. And we find that in Exodus chapter 28, verse 2. He said it was meant for glory and for beauty. When God was going to hint us about salvation through prophet Isaiah, in Isaiah 61, verse 10, Isaiah 61, verse 10, Isaiah 61, verse 10, he spoke about our garment of salvation. In order to fulfill our primary duty to praise God, he also mentioned what is called the garment of praise. In other words, he tailor-made that garment for praise. We found that in Isaiah chapter 63, verse 3, Isaiah 63, verse 3, Isaiah 63, verse 3. Many times when we miss it due to our pride and self-righteousness, he cuts us back to size by calling our garments, calling all our righteousness like a filthy garment, describing it as a filthy garment in his presence. We see that in Isaiah 64, verse 6, Isaiah 64, 6, Isaiah 64, 6. Now, this filthy garment came up again in Zechariah chapter 3, verses 3 to 4. Zechariah 3, 3 to 4. Zechariah 3, 3 to 4. When out of his mercies, he removed that garment from his body of the high priest in that verse of the scripture. Garments are very central to the scriptures, and they were instruments of miracles in the hands of Elisha in 2 Kings 2, 14. 2 Kings 2, 14. 2 Kings 2, 14. In crossing the Jordan, he also needed it. He used it to walk on the Jordan, and the Jordan parted. Now, when we are talking about garments or raiments or clothes or any item that we use to cover our body, we are talking about the glory of God. We need the glory of God to cover us everywhere that we go. Praise the Lord. Amen. And this glory is transferable through what we have on our bodies. I have heard the Jew said many times about how he will just take off the tie or a collection of ties that he has worn to minister, and God has used him, and he will call his subordinates and, you know, share it to them, and they have come back with testimonies to him. I also know a man of God in my younger days as a Christian. I'm still growing, I'm still learning. He was a prophet then, and he was so anointed that somebody needed to put on his undergarment, in other words, his singlet, to be able to attend an interview. And one way or the other, the man got the job. Now, I'm not saying it was a singlet that does the job, but sometimes these things are just medium that God uses. So those two examples are just to tell us how important the garment or the clothing that we have on. If you look at Luke 8:43 to 48, that was the only thing that stood between that woman with the issue of blood and her healing. Bible says she's telling her heart that if I can, but touch the hem of his garment. We see garments coming up to play a very prominent and important position in the testimony of that woman that she shared them. It's so important that even when Jesus was nailed to the cross, Bible says the people who nailed him to the cross, they were not concerned with any other thing except his garment, that is the clothes that he wore. John 19:23 said they actually organized a competition, a kind of a bargain or a game to be able to know who goes away with the garment. Now, if you have an appointment with the president of any country, maybe Buckingham Palace here, you have an appointment with the Queen. Now, they have checked you in, you have everything, all the appointments, all the letters, they've taken your photograph, everything that you need, all the protocols, all the boxes that you need to see the Queen, you have ticked everything. If you are not well dressed, upon all your letter of appointment and upon everything, they will turn you back. Why? Because you are about to go and see the number one person in the country, and that means there will probably be some world press, some world journalists there, and all these things sometimes are beamed live. If you are not well dressed, you are sent back, and it doesn't matter whether it was the Queen himself that asked you to come. When God was going to hint us about salvation through Prophet Isaiah, in Isaiah 61 verse 10, he spoke about our garment of salvation. So in order to fulfill our primary duty to God, which is praising him, we also needed that particular garment that God has actually made for us, which is called the garment of praise. Hallelujah. Joseph understood the importance of his garment in Genesis 41 verse 14. So much so that at the moment he was released from the prison, Bible says the first thing he did was that he shaved himself and he changed his garment, because you have to be well dressed when you want to go in to see the Queen. Jesus was speaking about a parable, which is called the parable of the wedding feast. There were so many people in attendance in that parable and in that wedding feast, that wedding reception. But there was a man who came in the wrong garment. Matthew 22:11. Now, he had the pass to come into that meeting. He had the letter to attend that wedding. But because his garment was not right, Bible says he was identified by the host of that meeting, and he was sent out, not for any other reason, but because he wasn't mindful of his garment. Now, your garment in a wrong hand is an instrument in the hands of the devil. Your garment in a wrong hand is an instrument in the hands of the devil. That was what almost happened to Joseph in the house of Potiphar. Bible says that woman, the only thing the woman went for was Joseph's garment. He took the garment because she wanted to use it as an evidence. Genesis 39:1-11. So your garment in a wrong hand could actually cause mayhem and havoc in your spiritual life or my spiritual life. I remember sometimes, I think this was 1984, when the present president of Nigeria, Muhammadu Buhari, first came as a military major general then. So he came up with some drastic rules and a lot of people were arrested. I remember there was a man called Bafilomi Owo, the name's talking about him. He was physically arrested and then obviously they found some drugs in his possession. Now he denied the ownership of those drugs, and of course what we now call DNA wasn't as developed as it is now. So they couldn't trace the ownership of those drugs to him. But they knew it was his box. He denied it and he was well on the way to succeeding in actually dissociating himself from the ownership of that bag. But what gave him out? All the things in that bag, they asked him to be putting them on one after the other. The shoe was just exactly his size. The clothes, the singlet, everything in that bag was exactly his size. Which then means your garments in the hand of a wrong person can cause problems in people's lives. So wrong acquisition of a garment by Achan. Wrong acquisition of a garment by Achan was what caused a setback for the people of Israel in their battle with Ai in Joshua chapter 7. When your garment is torn into two, the consequences are severe in the spirit world. The kingdom of Solomon was rent into two in 1 Kings chapter 11 verse 30, 1 Kings 11 30, 1 Kings 11 30, and as a result of that, we had a divided Israel of Northern Kingdom and Southern Kingdom, which was also called Judah. But that's just by way of introduction. What we are focusing on this morning is your garment and my garment. This whole exercise that we are having here, and I've had Brandon repeated it in the Sunday school this morning, is just a big rehearsal. The main assignment, what we are rehearsing for, is what is called the marriage feast of the Lamb. That is why our clothes must be clean. That is why our clothes must be without blemish and it must be without wrinkle. Now, when a bride turns up at a wedding, people dress the bride adorn the bride in many beautiful things, maybe the ring, the heart, the face, everything is done beautifully. But the first thing 90% of people see when a bride turns up is the garment that she's putting. They want to be very sure that this is the bride. And the bride's clothes is usually different on that occasion. You see a lot of flowers being thrown. You see the bridal train. Sometimes the clothes, what was it called? The back part of the garment might even stretch maybe a mile or two. I've seen people do that. But you see, what we are focusing on, if we imagine you and I as brides of Christ, what we are focusing on is not the quality of the garment. It's not the size of it. It's not how netty or how nylon or how woolly it is. We are looking at the color of the garment. And when we say white, I have also come to discover that there are different shades of what? White. I wrote some of them down here. I didn't know they were that much. There is off-white. They called another one ghost white. There is smoke white, there is snow white, there is milk white, there is chalk white, and there is dirty white. Praise the Lord. So what kind of white is yours this morning? When the Almighty God called me and sent me on this assignment, one of the things he said is that I called you to save the demands of eternal sentences. I tried all the time to work within that. And it has to do with the state of the heart and the holiness of life. And that's a very important distinction between sanctification and justification by God alone. I didn't read many parts of the scriptures. When he explained to me that justification happens just once in a man's lifetime if the person understands what he's doing. A message is preached, an altar call is made, the response comes to that, you lift up your hands, you break down in tears, and you make a U-turn, and you are born again. So you are justified from that day. Justification is just as if you didn't do it before. So you are restored back to the original position when God created Adam and Eve. For it said, when we are talking about sanctification, sanctification comes immediately after justification. Because from that day you begin to walk differently. And then you sanctify yourself every day. The only equipment or the only thing that God has made available for our sanctification is His word and His blood. His word and His blood. So, I have come this morning to remind us that the quality of our garment is not too important like a color. If it is off-white, let's do whatever we can to bring it back to white. If it is milky white, let's do everything possible to bring it back to white. If it is smoke white, let's do everything possible to bring it back to white. Now, rapture will happen one day. I got a message on WhatsApp yesterday. I'm sure many of us have got like a picture. And they said this just happened in London now. It was the face of Jesus on the sky. Sometimes they put the face of Mary. Sometimes they put the face of whoever. But the truth, according to the Bible, is that Jesus is coming back.
Amen.
And when He comes back, will He find your garment white? Will He find my garment white? We're talking about the state of the heart. What are the things that can affect or that can discredit our garment of righteousness? Bible spoke about some garments being wrinkled. They said wrinkled garment. When a garment is wrinkled, it may be pure, complete snow white. But if it is wrinkled, it's not well ironed, there's a problem. A wrinkled garment talks about or points to a child of God who is still bound by traditions in the church. Traditions. This is how we do it. This is what we can wear. This is what we cannot wear. Bible says, Paul may water, Paul may plant, Apollo may water. It's only God that can give the increase. So when we are still bound by traditions, our garment is wrinkled. Now, when a garment is spotted, that is when you and I choose to live in sin. Especially in this case of Achan. That was a great spot in the life of the garments of the people of Israel. If a garment has blemish, a blemished garment is worn by a man who has a misunderstanding of the purpose of the church. If your understanding of what the church stands for or what the church is aiming to be, if it is blemished in any form, then that garment is blemished. And this is what we are talking about when these essential things that are taught in the maturity classes, like Trinity, like heaven, like sin, like the place of the Holy Spirit, like divinity, and all of that, if it's not put in proper perspective, no matter how Christianly you appear, and no matter the amount of years you are spent in the house of the Lord, that garment is with a blemish. That garment is with a blemish. It's very, very, very easy to get confused in the house of God if there's no balance in terms of the statement of faith and what we believe in. If our understanding of what Jesus Christ came to do and what He left the church to continue after He has left, if we don't have an understanding of it, it becomes very, very easy to have a rewarding walk with the Lord. And I pray that this morning, it's going to be a very short message, I pray that this morning, that as we have been reminded, everything I've said this morning now, it's not new to me. Something we've had for ages and ages. But sometimes, Bible says, faith comes by hearing, and hearing the word of God at the same time. I won't come here to preach any message if the message has not circumcised my heart first. If the message has not dealt with me first, because I believe Bible says, when the oil was on the head of Aaron, he went all the way down, on to the garment. And I pray that this morning, any time that trumpet will sound, because Bible says a day will come when that strong angel will beat his trumpet and he will blow it. When he blow it, I pray that as soon as the dead in Christ, as soon as they rise, you and I will also get caught up with them. Bible says, of what use is it for a man to gain the whole world and lose his life in hell? Because what shall a man give in exchange? What shall a man give in exchange? What shall a man give in exchange for his soul? There's a bitter battle, bitter argument going on in the spirit world about what? About the soul of man. That's how precious you are in him. And I believe that by the grace of the Almighty God, that voice that comes to the children of disobedience on the last day, on the last day, which says, go away with me, you walk out of iniquity, because I don't know you, will not come to you. Amen. In Jesus' name. Amen. Let's rise to our feet this afternoon and go to God and ask him if there's any blemish, if there's any spot, if there's any wrinkle in your garment or in my garment. Let's go for the cleansing power of the Lord Jesus Christ. Tap into Jesus for his cleansing power. I am washed in the blood of the Lamb. Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of... If you know that song, then let's sing it together. Then.
I am washed in the blood, in the soul cleansing blood of the Lamb. Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Have you been to Jesus for his cleansing blood? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood?
You at the very point of your need, as he has always done. God bless you.